Good morning. Can I welcome everyone to this, the second meeting of the Public Audit Committee in 2024. The first item on the committee's agenda is for members to agree or not to take agenda items 3 and 4 in private. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. I should also note that the Deputy Convener, Sharon Dowie, is joining us online this morning. The principal agenda item that we have before us this morning is consideration of the Auditor General's Section 22 report into the Scottish Government Consolidated Accounts. And I'm particularly pleased to welcome our witnesses this morning, the most senior team from the Scottish Government. And we have the Permanent Secretary joining us, John Paul Marks. You're very welcome. The Director General Economy, Gregor Irwin, is also here. Jackie McAllister, who's the Chief Finance Officer. And also joining us is Alison Cumming, who's the Director of Budget and Public Spending in the Scottish Government. We've got quite a wide range of questions that we want to put to you this morning, Permanent Secretary. But before we get to those, could I invite you to make a short opening statement?
Yeah, thank you, Convener. Good morning, everyone, and Happy New Year to you all. Another busy year ahead. Firstly, grateful to the Auditor General for his unqualified audit opinion on the annual accounts. 22-23 was a year of disruption and external shocks, including high inflation, high interest rates, and low growth, and it was managed accordingly with increased financial control, prioritisation, and savings exercises. If I may just take the chance, Convener, to put on record my appreciation to Audit Scotland, to Stephen and the teams, and to my Chief Finance Officer and her teams. Leading through this context has been challenging. There's been tough moments, and the support, collaboration has been greatly appreciated. Overall, these accounts thankfully show an underspend as required. The final outturn against the Treasury budgets will be published soon. The provisional outturn reports an underspend of 0.5% of the total budget, which is £244 million, which has been carried forward openly via the reserve into this financial year and utilised in full. I'm grateful to Audit Scotland for the support, recognising improving transparency on the reserve, and we'll keep working on that. The budget was balanced via a £1 billion emergency budget review transparently set out to Parliament. That EBR protected support in a cost of living crisis that included expansion of the Scottish Child Payments, uprated and now supporting over 320,000 under 16s. And that has contributed to child poverty being 9 percentage points lower in Scotland than would otherwise have been the case. The EBR also enabled pay settlements agreed, which minimised the impact of industrial action in Scotland's public services. Happy to confirm to the committee we have a path to balance this year too, and Budget 24-25 is now, of course, being scrutinised by Parliament. Just turning to the Section 22 report very briefly, I welcome the recommendations in full. Happy to confirm a governance review is underway in the Scottish Government. We've established the Strategic Commercial Assets Division. I really welcome the recognition from Audit Scotland that has strengthened management of financial interventions. Gregor has joined us at DG Economy last year and is with us today, and we will keep building that capability as the committee would expect. We have strengthened some other core corporate capabilities, freedom of information, performance, propriety and ethics, stricter EPC controls, as well, and we're developing a long-term public service reform programme across estate, digital, income, workforce and shared services to deal with underlying financial pressures. Finally, we will, of course, as Audit Scotland recommend, press on with our corporate transformation programme to ensure our core systems are fit for purpose, responding to Audit Scotland's reported concerns and to realise future efficiencies. Convener, last year we promised to develop a performance report that is included in the accounts, and it's about establishing mission-led government across equality to reduce poverty, opportunity to grow our economy and achieve net zero by 2045, and community to transform our public services and recover our pandemic backlogs. We've published portfolio mandate letters to transparently set out what each portfolio is to achieve, and the statutory review of national outcomes and the national performance framework will conclude this year. Finally, Convener, I've written to you on public sector accounts. We've had some initial discussions on the next phase of that work, and I'm hopeful we can make good progress on those in the months ahead. I just want to close by thanking colleagues and partners for their resilience and collaboration as our work continues in the year ahead to achieve our goals and, of course, improve our national outcomes wherever we can. We look forward to the committee meeting this morning. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Permanent Secretary, for that introduction, and it covers many of the areas that I think we want to speak to you about this morning. Can I take you back to one of the fundamental key messages from the Auditor General's report on the Scottish Government's consolidated accounts, where he says, and I quote, "The delivery of public services is not affordable in its current form." How do you react to that?
Yeah, so I think, as I set out in my statement, the public services across all four nations have gone through a set of shocks over the last few years. Inflation has impacted the underlying cost base of capital programmes, of resource budgets, and that has affected every part of the public sector. It's true also voluntary sector and for business. So it's very important, of course, that as these accounts show, we balance the budget, a lawful requirement to do so. That's true in these accounts for 2022-23. As I said, we are on track to do so again this year. And to achieve that, savings exercises, prioritisation and reform are all key elements of that. The Deputy First Minister has set out in her budget the choices the government has made to ensure that next year's budget is indeed balanced also. But we need to, of course, continue to transform our public services to deliver better outcomes. And that's where that long-term public service reform programme, how we can utilise digital enablers, shared services, improve efficiency and productivity, is going to be really essential, because we want to, of course, balance the budget and improve outcomes. And we've got some good examples where that's working well, but we can't deny that the level of pressure the public services are facing because of what's available following the autumn statement envelope, given our tax revenues, given levels of growth, creates a significant challenge. And the public service reform programme is set up long term to try and ensure that we're doing the right things to be fiscally sustainable.
Okay, I mean, obviously you are the principal accountable officer in the government. I mean, is it your view that the government's policy objects are affordable and sustainable?
It is, I think, but it's with a significant challenge. So, you know, if you look at the choices that government is faced with, they are clearly significantly complex because of the constraints on public expenditure growth. And it puts a real premium on the need for reform. Long-term, fiscal sustainability will be a function of choices that are made in the UK government around the block grant, what our tax revenues are and what our expenditure is. So certainly this time last year, when we looked at 23-24, there was a real concern around being able to balance the budget, which is why the emergency budget, the recurring savings exercises were necessary to take the choices to do so. We are going to have to continue with that discipline. We're going to have to continue with the discipline of prioritisation, focusing on value for money, doing the very best we can to support chief executives to transform, raise revenue where they have the empowerment to do so. But there's no doubt that the underlying sustainability risk is there. It's one of the key risks at our corporate board. We talk with it with our audit function regularly, and it's why we're trying to address those underlying reform enablers to support leaders with delivering within their budget allocation.
Okay, I mean, you mentioned the block grant. There's just been a renegotiation of the fiscal framework. Are you satisfied with the outcome of that renegotiation?
I am. The fiscal framework changes, I think, are positive. Real credit to the team, because given the context we were in, I was slightly surprised that it did get over the line, but I was pleased with it. So from Scotland's perspective, you know, the block grant mechanism in terms of being indexed per capita, you know, baselining that assumption is important for us. In terms of resource borrowing, we were previously able to borrow up to 300 million to cover forecast error. That is now up to 600 million and indexed to inflation. Similarly, our capital borrowing now indexed to inflation. That creates headroom longer term, which gives us opportunities with regards bond issuance or further borrowing. We've removed the limits on reserve drawdown, and the overall reserve limit has been indexed to inflation. So taking all of that together, I think those are improvements to the fiscal framework from Scotland's perspective. Previously, without that operating, our real terms flexibilities were degrading. Now they're not. That's not to say there won't be more conversations on the fiscal framework in the future. But in terms of getting that done, obviously coming towards the end of a UK Parliament with the Chief Secretary and the Deputy First Minister, we were pleased with and think it's a good settlement for devolution. Alison, I don't know if you want to add anything to that, but I think those are the headlines on the changes.
No, thanks. I would absolutely agree. Those are the headlines, and actually probably the most significant element for us financially is securing the permanency of the index per capita methodology for block grant adjustments, which the independent report that supported the fiscal framework review estimated could be worth 400 to 500 million a year at times to the Scottish budget, depending on assumptions on how population growth varies between Scotland and the rest of the UK. So we were satisfied that it was within the parameters of the review. It was a good outcome within those parameters.
Yeah, I mean, I think Without paraphrasing too heavily the Deputy First Minister, when she presented it to Parliament, she accepted that there was no fundamental change here. It was a rather modest improvement, I think. And it's a review every 5 years, Alison Cumming, is that how it works?
The review was agreed at the time of the original fiscal framework agreement being reached in 2016. I'm not aware that there's a set five-year commitment for the next review, but I think it's about keeping it under periodic review and keeping those discussions open with the Treasury.
Okay, thank you. I want to move on to a couple of other areas. I mean, I think we're agreed, and I think, Permanent Secretary, you've already referred to the fact that you accept that there needs to be public sector reform, and presumably one of the other recommendations you would also accept, which is about better workforce planning. Why was there no detail of either of those in the budget recently presented to Parliament?
Well, so I think it's quite difficult to summarise at a macro level precisely what needs to happen for every single workforce, and that does need to be done in different sectors. So if I take core Scottish Government civil service, when I arrived in 2022, the plans that I was presented with was for growth in the core civil service of up to around 2,000 headcount. We've actually kept that flat. We've taken around 500 contractors out of our core workforce. We expect to be marginally smaller this year. And given our budget allocation in terms of total operating costs, would look to continue with that trend. So our workforce is right-sizing to what we can afford, but it's also making sure we're trying to ensure we've got the right skills and capabilities, of course, to deliver our programme. And that thinking, that right-sizing, looking at spans of control, looking at the layers of organisations, making sure we are getting the right professional skills in the right places to deliver optimal value for money, we need every public body doing that, and we need all of our sectors doing that, whether it be health and social care, local governments, or the police. So the Chief Constable, the new Chief Constable, has a reform programme around the police. We've put investment into enabling that, And it's quite right that she is empowered to lead that with support from and scrutiny from Parliament and the committee. So we've set out, these are the enablers of public service reform, which I referenced, digital workforce, enabling revenue raising and income generation and cost recovery where it's appropriate to do so, commercial value for money programme, and there are others. And then ultimately asking every portfolio, every sponsor team, working with their sectors, working with their public bodies to make sure that they live within their budgets, but also they're optimising their transformation to deliver better outcomes. And yeah, Gregor could say a bit about an example in the economy portfolio we saw from Scottish Enterprise on Monday, setting out their strategy, their missions, how they are delivering to optimise their outcomes given their budget allocation. I think it's right that the Chief Executive and the Board of Scottish Enterprise do that rather than we try and control that centrally. But of course, they have a budget allocation and they need to right size and deliver within that accordingly.
Can I just pick you up on your language? I mean, you describe it as right sizing, but in the case of Scottish Enterprise, isn't it downsizing?
Well, so Scottish Enterprise have seen a reduction in their budget.
Count.
And similarly, there are elements of their budget. Some of it will be resource, others will be programme spend. And I think it's quite right that where an organisation has scaled up to respond to the challenges, whether that was around pandemic, Brexit, cost of living crisis, we are asking those leaders to look at every line of their budget, obviously live within their allocation and make sure it's optimised, because that's their responsibility to the taxpayer. You know, every time that we don't do that, we leave that pressure for the taxpayer to pick up. But I don't know, Gregor, do you want to say a bit more about public service reform on Scots Enterprise and in the economy sector?
Yes, thank you. So as Permanent Secretary has already noted, Scottish Enterprise on Monday set out its new strategy. It's focused on three core missions, energy transition, innovation, investment, three priorities closely aligned with the National Strategy for Economic Transformation. The headcount in Scottish Enterprise has decreased, and it will decrease further. It is absolutely right that Scottish Enterprise, like other parts of the public sector, embraces digital forms of delivery. We've seen that. The organisation is keen to move further in that direction. But that focus and that focus on those core missions, that is essential for Scottish Enterprise as part as its contribution to public sector reform, but equally it's important for other parts of the public sector to similarly ensure that they have that focus as well and that they embrace those enabling capability steps in order to be more efficient and ensure value for money.
So when you say similarly, you mean we can expect other public sector organisations to downsize as well?
I mean,
yes, right.
I think that's true. I mean, I don't think we can pretend otherwise, you know, and I think actually the public sector in Scotland, for good reason, we, you know, take a lot of pride in the fact that we've got smaller class sizes, for example. We've got more police per capita. We've got more fire officers per capita. That enables us to, you know, for example, in education, provide more support for those children that need it in a smaller school environment. So our pupil-teacher ratio is just over 13, I think, in Scotland. It's over 18 in England and Wales. But when we look across our whole public sector, back to your point, Convener and Audit Scotland's challenge on long-term fiscal sustainability, you know, we have got to be confident that the resource budget is affordable. And that will be a function of the block grant. The fiscal framework helps us with that marginally, and our tax revenues. And this budget has set out, the Deputy First Minister has set out, some of the choices necessary to do that. And public service reform absolutely asks every leader of every public body to be confident that they are optimising their outcomes given what they can afford. And given the impact of inflation, which has been higher than anyone expected for longer, that has eaten into the underlying spending power of our public sector. And so to balance that, given the limitations of what we can achieve through tax revenue and growth, we need to right-size the public sector to be affordable. And that will happen across the systems, but it's absolutely clear that that should be empowered according to the needs of those particular organisations. The Scottish National Investment Bank is very different to Scottish Enterprise. So we don't sit at the centre and tell them precisely what their headcount should be, but we use a level of empowerment and sponsorship to support them in their public sector transformation.
Well, if you'll forgive me, my reading of what you're saying is that reform equals contraction and right-sizing equals downsizing. I'm going to bring Graeme Simpson in a second. I just wanted to just ask one hopefully straightforward question which will elicit a quick answer. There isn't currently public sector pay guidelines, and that they weren't part and parcel, again, of the fabric of the budget presented to Parliament. Can we expect to see public sector pay guidelines being issued?
Yes, you can expect to see those. We're in January. Those would be for from April 24-25. I think last year, if I recall, we published them in the spring. We've not seen pay guidance yet from other governments on a four nations basis, as I recall. But absolutely, we will need to, of course, set those parameters for 24-25. And what we want to achieve, as we have managed to date, of course, is that very positive dialogue with our trade union colleagues so that we can sustain our public services. Some of our public services, just to take your point, take the point about, be brief, but some of our public services are seeing growth, and that's necessary to deal with demand. So if I take Social Security Scotland, for example, they are taking on more benefits. They are migrating more benefits from DWP. That volume will rise. So they have been recruiting, quite right too, as they've also improved their productivity to support more clients per day. And it is part of an overarching intent to improve outcomes and improve value for money. But yes, pay guidance will follow later this year.
Okay, thank you very much. Graeme Simpson. Graeme.
Thanks very much, Convener. I just want to follow up on what the Convener was asking about. So you've been quite clear that you think the number of people employed in the public sector needs to come down. Are you able to put a figure on that?
No, I don't think so. I think that was the point the convener was trying to make around could the budget have done that? And I don't think we have a precise planning assumption about what that will mean, because it is different for different public bodies. So, as I say, Scottish Enterprise may find themselves being smaller, Scottish National Investment Bank may not, depends on the position they're in their trajectory, but that is something that is empowered within the sponsor team, with that chief executive, with their board, given their budget allocation. Certainly for the core civil service, we expect to be marginally smaller. We've reduced our contractors, and given our budget allocation, we would expect that to continue. But there are other areas, for example, in our court recovery programme, where we've done an excellent job to bring down the backlog from the pandemic. It was down by over a third compared to where it was from its peak. We need to sustain that because we want to get that backlog down, reduce the demand in the system, also support a reduction in the remand population in our prison service, and that will improve outcomes and improve value for money. So it's not as simple as saying everybody will be smaller and every system will be smaller. It's different according to different systems, and the budget allocations reflect those choices that ministers have made.
So, I mean, for example, in courts, you've just mentioned courts, and you mentioned police earlier. Yeah. I would presume that we wouldn't be suggesting that we see cuts in those areas, but from what you've just said, there'll be cuts in other areas. When will you be able to set out, you know, what is going to happen where?
So, as you say, those two good examples, the police settlement, Alison will be able to say a bit more on the detail, working with the Chief Constable, given our intent, of course, to keep crime low, to protect that investment in our police service so that Police Scotland can continue to do the preventative community work that they're so well recognised for. The investment into our police service, we think, will enable us to maintain our police numbers and to maintain that exceptional service and actually to transform some of the technology enablers for that service. Similarly, I talked about courts and the Crown Office, where, again, we want to complete on that recovery. So by the end of this Parliament, as quickly as possible, we're able to say that the pandemic backlogs are behind us. In terms of when will every public body be able to explain precisely their long-term workforce plan, I think that's something that the Public Service Reform Programme wants to, we want to work on, because, as you know, part of the challenge of the fiscal framework and the way in which our allocation comes through the block grant is it's annual. And what a lot of people would prefer is to have much more multi-year certainty on both resource and capital for longer term planning purposes. And that would then include long-term strategic workforce plans. It's a bit harder to do that when it's annual budget allocations. Nonetheless, we're asking each portfolio to work with each of their public bodies on their long-term workforce strategies and plans. So that can be included in updates. I think we've committed to 6 monthly updates to FPAC committee. And similarly, if this committee would like regular updates on that programme, how that's going, how different systems are transforming, we'd be very happy to do that. Because I think this is the long-term challenge for Scotland, and it answers the convener's fair challenge at the beginning. To be sustainable, we need to be affordable. But we don't want that to be about cuts. We want that to be about reform. So we improve outcomes, improve experiences, improve the efficiency and the productivity of the public sector as we go through that journey. And it's not an easy thing to take on, but there are some wonderful examples: Disclosure Scotland, Records of Scotland, Social Security. You can see some very good evidence of productivity improvement. We need to continue with that across the whole system.
I think it would be useful if this committee were to have those updates. You mentioned the Crown Office. Now, the Auditor General mentioned in his report the Rangers case. Now, I'm not going to ask you about the Rangers case, but I'm going to ask you about something more topical, and that's around the Post Office. My question is simply, are you allocating money for potential compensation for people wrongly convicted in that case in Scotland?
So the Lord Advocate made her statement to Parliament, and the First Minister, I think was it yesterday, set out the latest, given the response from the Prime Minister with regards to this. So our team are now working closely with the UK government on the opportunity of that legislative consent motion, which would then enable people to access that compensation scheme. So that work is happening rapidly. And if there was any provision needed, I'm sure the First Minister, his determination is very clear that compensation must be accessible, and this process needs to be as swift as possible, which is why he wrote to the Prime Minister immediately, and the Prime Minister responded. So there isn't a provision in the 24-25 budget specifically for the Crown Office for this, because the intent is to get the consent motion through such that we can access the compensation scheme. But the Crown Office quite clearly can prioritise their budget to ensure that any activity to support that effort is taken forward.
That money would have to come from Scotland, wouldn't it? Because there were prosecutions. The prosecutions in Scotland were through the Crown Office.
Yeah, and I think we'll need to just confirm the accounting of how that would work, given the way in which the compensation scheme has been set up and the nature of how that would be accessed. But I think I can reassure the committee that all the messaging that Parliament's already heard from the First Minister and the directions that have been to us as a Scottish Government is we must make sure that access to compensation is as swift as possible, and quite right too.
Okay. I'm going to ask you about something else now. And this was the electronic procurement card review management report, which has been published fairly recently. Well, actually, the date on it was December 2023. So just for those watching, I mean, this came, I think this emerged from an FOI, possibly from the Labour Party convener, which outlined a whole series of very unusual purchases made through a Scottish government. I don't know whether they were physical cards, but, well, e-cards anyway. People spending taxpayers' money on a whole variety of things, including a number of books. There were six copies of Women Hold Up Half the Sky. That was the selected speeches of Nicola Sturgeon. I imagine that would be a fairly slim thing. 19 copies of How to Run a Government So That Citizens Benefit and Taxpayers Don't Go Crazy. I think it's probably a bit late for that. One copy of Taxation, a very short introduction, which tells us that people adapt their activities in various ways to reduce the impact of taxation. One copy of Marx, a very short introduction. Another book called The Blunders of Our Governments. Various self-help books, including one on irritable bowel syndrome. There's a copy of Scotland's Future, which was actually a Scottish Government book. I don't know why you're buying your own book. But in this report, you say that all these various books and other things, like midge repellent and a traffic fine, are appropriate. How can these things be appropriate?
So if we just go back to the beginning a bit on this, there was a Freedom of Information request whereby 58,000 transactions were released, which showed all of the spending using EPC cards over a 3-year period. The First Minister then quite rightly commissioned two reviews into what happened here, both in terms of a cyber investigation into the data handling, but then also a review that I undertook on the policies and procedures around the use of these cards. As I said in my opening statement, we have put stricter controls in place. There were a number of, as you say, Mr. Simpson, a number of transactions which were raised, which were investigated, and I set out in that report, which we published, to explain those. There was one transaction which was fraudulent, in the system and not authorised by the card holder. That card was deactivated and the expenditure was refunded. But for all the others, we've set out on what basis they were used. And look, you know, I think the purchasing of books for training and personal development and used by the library, etc., part of the stricter controls is being clear that we should hold those, people should borrow them and don't need to purchase multiple copies. We've reduced the single monthly transaction limits. We already publish everything quarterly that's over £500, introduced mandatory and refresher training for everyone with EPC responsibilities, and set out some further messaging around the importance, of course, of value for money, including, you know, away days in, for example, public sector estates, wherever possible. My director for commercial, Nick Ford, wrote to the convener for the committee on the 8th of January in terms of the management report and the next steps with regards to that. And again, a bit like the previous conversation, if the committee would appreciate it, we're very happy to provide a further update later this year on the steps being taken to control this and to tighten up the controls further as we go through this year.
My concern is if the view is that all the, you know, the various purchases, some of which I've read out, are deemed to be appropriate, this kind of nonsense will continue. I mean, surely it's not, it cannot be appropriate that you're buying books on titles like How to Run a Government. That is not appropriate use of taxpayers' money.
I think if I recall, forgive me if I might get this wrong, that book is written by the former head of the Number 10 Implementation Unit. Actually, one of the key things that we have been working on since I became Perm Sec, but all governments always working on, is how to improve outcomes. How to improve our use of data to transform to be a mission-led government, to learn from the mistakes of the past and translate that into the way we work. But Mr. Simpson, genuinely, if there is a particular transaction in there in the report for which you have concern, genuinely welcome to write to me and I will write back with a further explanation on them. I went through them with my audit team, my commercial team, and the guidance does allow teams to purchase books that will support learning and development. Having said that, we have made sure through the refresher training, through the controls, that and through the publication and transparency of the data, that we don't want multiple copies of books being purchased where they can be held by the library and borrowed. But as I say, you're finding a few transactions which were raised in the context of 58,000 over 3 years. And I think what you'll find if you go and look at similar transactions, similar governments, the purchasing of books for development is not novel.
These are not books for development. Some of these books are the things that I might put on my Christmas card list, and I would buy them, not the book of Nicola Sturgeon's speeches, of course, but they're not about learning and development. A book about Marx is not helping anyone's learning and development, well, unless it's the Green Party. But I'll take you up on that.
No, please, because we went through a very comprehensive exercise. And Mr. Simpson, I don't want to, you know, the whole exercise is not comfortable, you know, because clearly we want to, and I, you know, I don't know if I can make it more clear to the committee, you know, being custodians of taxpayers' money is something we take very seriously. We want to ensure value for money, efficiency, the very best possible outcomes we can. I won't comment on whether a book by Marx is relevant to anyone's development. I'm sure there's political theorists out there who have a view. The convener looking at me suggesting he might have a view on that. But we went through the transactions one by one to check, were they fraudulent? Were they contrary to the guidance at the time? Forgive me, but you know, some of these predated my being here. We've tightened the guidance, changed the limits, reduced the number of cards, refreshed the training annually, and have a detailed improvement plan to ensure that whenever we use these cards, we're very clear it's, you know, stationary, it's IT. People were suddenly moved into that working from home environment where these cards were utilised to ensure that they could access what they needed to continue to work through the pandemic. But we want to tighten it up. That's why we did the internal audit report. That's been made available to Audit Scotland as well. As I say, if there's any particular individual transactions you have a concern of, I'm very happy that Nick and I look at them again, provide you with more detail.
I will write to you, Permanent Secretary.
Okay.
Thank you.
Oh, okay, thank you. Just again for the record, because it's not entirely clear to me in my reading of the accompanying note that goes with the table of purchases made. It refers to the fact that the monthly limit on the UK government e-card is £10,000, whereas the Scottish government limit has been £25,000 per month. And it talks about a realignment or alignment. Could you confirm today whether the Scottish government monthly limit for the e-card use is going to come in line with the UK government level of £10,000?
Yeah, that's my understanding. So immediate changes that we implemented to align included reducing the single and monthly transaction limits to £5,000 and £10,000, which I think is the same as the UK government's limits. So I'll double check that, but that's my understanding as well. So a number of steps that we went through to put those stricter controls in place, including that one.
And when it talks about, again, against these listed items that were purchased with the e-card, it talks about, uses the expression out of scope quite a lot. Could you just elaborate what that means? Does that mean that these things that Mr. Simpson spoke about are still in scope, or are they out of scope? Are they out of scope full stop? Are they out of scope for the e-card, or are they in scope?
I think I'm going to have to look at the sentence you're referring to in terms of, forgive me, I'm not quite clear exactly,
Well, pretty much every item is categorised, and it's, for example, there's one here, taxation, a very short introduction, and marks, a very short introduction, are both listed as appropriate under current policy, recommended to review policy exclusions,
gotcha,
and out-of-scope expenditure moving forward.
Yeah.
So what does that mean?
So, taking the point on books, my preference would be if somebody needs to access a book for development or training or research, the library purchases the book and it is available then for people to borrow, rather than EPC cards are used for that purpose. So it is amending the guidance in terms of the scope of what EPC cards can be used for. But as I say, Nick wrote to the committee on the 8th of January confirming the management report and next steps. And if the committee would like, we can ask him to provide a further update, including what was in scope, what's not anymore or won't be going forward, and he can cover any particular transactions where there is still a concern.
Yeah, thank you. I think that would be helpful. Yeah. Can I take us back to the substantive report that we're discussing this morning, which is the Auditor General's Section 22 report? And again, just to get your position on the record, Permanent Secretary, paragraphs 95 and 96 are the conclusion of the report. And paragraph 96 carries with it a series of five very clear recommendations from the Auditor General about a change in approach, a development of approach, and so on, in terms of accessibility, transparency, governance and assurance arrangements, the public sector estate, a roadmap of how the design and delivery of public services, which we've already spoken about this morning, a roadmap of what that looks like and how you will advance that, a timetable for completion as a matter of urgency on the whole government accounts, which we're going to get to shortly. Do you accept the conclusions and recommendations in that paragraph of the report?
Yep, we do. And Stephen, I'm going to sat behind me. We have a lot of conversations very regularly. I think we've got a very good relationship going with our teams. Genuinely commend the work that Audit Scotland have been doing. They're improving value for money. They're improving efficiency in our public sector. We want to do the same. We want to improve transparency. We want to improve the scrutiny so that Parliament, the public, our taxpayers can be confident they're getting optimal value for money and outcomes. I think all those recommendations talk to that. As I said, the governance review is underway, so we want to make sure it's proportionate, streamlined, efficient. When I arrived, we put quite a lot of changes in around a delivery executive, for example, meeting every Thursday, focused on performance, outcomes, and trying to get that golden thread, which I accept Audit Scotland quite right. We've got more to do in the performance report to take that through to the national outcomes, so it's very clear how investment today is having both a short, medium and long-term impact to improve outcomes in Scotland. The corporate transformation programme, quite right, responding to previous concerns that Audit Scotland had around systems and processes not being fit for purpose, insufficient investment, that is being corrected. We've talked about public service reform. We've come on to whole government accounts. And we've had that report come to our audit committee, where Audit Scotland attend with our lead non-executives to go through each of those recommendations, and we can respond to each of them at this committee, either in writing and or when we appear next year, as you prefer.
That's fine, but you accept the conclusions, and we'll ask questions to get into a bit more of the detail of some aspects of those in the remaining time that we've got. And I'm going to bring in Willie Coffey at this point. Willie.
Thanks very much, Convener. Good morning to you. Just on the previous conversation there about books, I hope we are not going down the road where politicians can determine what people can and can't read, or should and shouldn't read. I think people who do make purchases must be able to justify that within whatever framework we have in place. But whoever reaches a position where people are saying you must not and cannot read something, that's not a direction of travel I would like to follow. On the issue about the post office that Mr Simpson raised, is it your understanding, Permanent Secretary, that both the post office and Fujitsu will also be providing a compensation fund for the cases that emerged as a result of the post office scandal?
Just on that last point, I think, and forgive me, because obviously this situation moving very quickly, I think if the committee would like more detail on precisely how that is all going to work, it's something we can provide in writing. And I say that only because, you know, the First Minister wrote to the UK government, was it last week? They only replied this week, and there's a statutory inquiry underway. And the inquiry will, of course, conclude with regards some of the points that you've made around the post office, around Fujitsu, and as we said earlier, the compensation scheme is there. We want to make sure the consent motion's in place and that anybody who was affected in Scotland can access it. But the precise details of how that will all work is being rapidly worked on right now, and I don't have certainty on that. And just on your first point, if I suggested any censorship with regards to what people can read, that was not my intent at all, and I'm with you 100%. You know, we want to create an environment where colleagues aren't paralysed into thinking they can't do the right things for their development. We want them to be empowered, and we want them to be supported in doing so, but we also need to make sure we respond to the concerns Mr Simpson sets out around transparency, accountability, value for money. And I think we're going to get the controls right now, so that will be the case, and improve the system. But of course, the committee quite rightly should hold us to account on that, and we'll make sure it's very visible. But in our responses, we'll also make clear the library should be encouraged to ensure the diversity of opinion and learning is available to people, so that our civil service is the best it can be, and not censored by ministers.
Thank you. Turning back to the consolidated accounts,
yes.
A couple of questions I'd like to ask you. Firstly, on underspends and borrowing. You, in your opening remarks, Permanent Secretary, you were talking about the current outturn position on underspend. The, when we got to the Auditor General's report, it was around about £500 million, we think, but I think you mentioned that it's £244 million. Could you just give us a brief explanation of how that and why that's moving and changed?
If it's OK, I might ask Jackie to do that because she is far better at it than I am. But yeah, Jackie, on you go.
Absolutely, Mr Coffey. So the accounts that we produce under the PFA Act require us to do so against the budgets that are voted and agreed by the Scottish Parliament. The final, well, provisional and final outturn that, again, we report to Parliament is based on the Treasury, the UK Government budgets, the block grant that we get. There is a difference between the two. So if we look at the annual accounts and the £500 million underspend, those were based on the budget set at the spring budget revision. After the spring budget revision, there were a number of funding adjustments. So final consequentials from the UK government were known. So we didn't have that at the time of the spring budget revision. And our final borrowing decisions were taken. That's the case in every year. That changed the funding by £187 million. So it reduced the £500 million underspend, if you like. There are a set of adjustments that are in the accounts. The accounts are not just about our spending power. We have got budgets for provisions, revaluation adjustments. So there's about £80 million in there that equates to non-cash type variances that we can't spend on anything else. So the spending power, if you like, is the underspend against the Treasury budgets that we carry forward through the Scotland Reserve. So the Scotland Reserve is driven by the fiscal framework. At provisional outturn, that underspend was £244 million, which is 0.5% of the budget that we have available. We haven't yet published the final outturn because there are some bodies that were being finalised, but we do expect that to be imminent, and we don't expect there to be a significant or substantial change from the provisional outturn figure. So that's the £244 million. It's carried forward through the Scotland Reserve. It's been fully deployed in 23-24, and absolutely no loss of spending power.
OK. What the public usually want to know is, see if that £244 million is the final outturn position. Does that carry forward into next year's budget, or do you lose it?
It's already been included in 23-24. So the Scotland Reserve, as the Permanent Secretary set out within the fiscal framework, we've got an overall cap of £700 million. So it's £700 million at the moment. So were we to be in a position where we were looking to carry forward more than that, there's a potential that we may lose that. We've not been in that position. And part of our year-end management and year-end strategy is making sure that we maximise the budget in year, accepting that we can't ever overspend our budget. So we always have to manage to some level of underspend. But as I say, this is 0.5% of the budget, and we think that that's modest.
Tolerance of what absolutely would be expected. Thank you very much for that. Permanent Secretary, you wrote to the committee to talk to us about the whole government accounts, the big picture. The committee's always been interested in getting as broad and as wide a view of every penny, really, that's spent by the government and its agencies that we can get. And also in your opening remarks, you were telling us a little bit about the progress that you've been making. You described it as phase one, phase two. And then in phase one, you've managed to, as I understand it, include other spending from other bodies, non-ministerial bodies, bodies that are funded by the budget. And it's really welcome that we can see that. But I wanted to focus your attention on the phase two side of it, where you say in your letter that because of our reliance on the UK government's whole government accounts picture, we haven't made the progress that we would want to have made. And you're in discussion with Audit Scotland about how to improve that situation in phase two. Could you just give the committee, I know it's a very dry subject, but could you give the committee some kind of flavour of what the problem is with our reliance on UK government, whole government accounts, and a little flavour of what you're actually trying to do to help us along that road?
Yeah, thank you. So again, I'll bring Jackie in. Jackie met with Audit Scotland last week on phase two and the opportunity of a sort of consolidated assets and liabilities report that we hope that we can produce for the committee. And actually, Jackie was telling me again a bit before my time, but when this work originally was thought through, that was the original intent of, can we have a sort of consolidated view of assets and liabilities for Scotland's public sector at a strategic level with a sufficient detail so we can see what that looks like and then direct scrutiny accordingly. So we're sort of going back to that original intent and seeing, can we get a method that Audit Scotland, working with us, we can produce for the committee, and in a way that gives us data that is sufficiently current that it will hopefully either inform decision making or inform current scrutiny. The problem we've had is to progress on the phase two whole government accounts, we had a dependency on the data that the Treasury and UK government were pulling together, and that has, due to the pandemic and a number of other factors, fallen behind. So we haven't been able to draw down and use that to create the phase two consolidation. But I think we've got a method to go forward and make progress here, back to the intent the committee had of show us a total view. But Jackie, do you want to just give us the latest on last week? And I don't want to be too optimistic here, but at the same time, I'd like us to get to a plan that the committee's content with and is actually deliverable. So I think to an extent we've been struggling to do something that wasn't feasible, but Jackie.
Yeah, thank you, Permanent Secretary. I think it's fair to say that when we talk about doing a set of accounts, there is a requirement on us as the Scottish Government in terms of those the accounting requirements within those, and of Audit Scotland in terms of the audit of those. And that's why the original proposal, it was so reliant on the whole of government accounts approach, which is a fairly intensive process that the UK government runs that ensures that the information is consolidated, aggregated, and interdepartmental balances, as we call them, are removed, that there is a common set of accounts, there's a single set of accounts, so you're reporting an apple alongside an apple, so to speak. And that therefore allows us to meet accounting standards around them, but also audit to meet the auditing standards. So it's quite a complex process. In the absence of that being and the information from the whole of government accounts being available to us, what we have tried to do is almost take a step back and respond obviously to the committee in terms of where is the interest, where is the public interest in terms of information that is not pulled together in one place at the moment, but that would add value to information that is already existing within individual accounts of these public bodies and public sector entities. And as the Permanent Secretary noted, the discussion that we're having with Audit Scotland is whether we can create something that isn't a set of accounts, but is additional financial information that consolidates the assets and liabilities of all the public sector bodies within Scotland that are funded through the Scottish government budget, and we can build on that. We can pull out different elements of the information trends over years, and we think it would be of interest, and it would provide more than is currently there. It also gives Audit Scotland, because it's not a set of accounts, the opportunity to comment on it without necessarily having to provide an audit opinion. So we think this is a workable way forward. What we want to ensure is that as we do this, that it will meet Audit Scotland's expectations and the committee's expectations, but we are quite positive that we can take forward a pilot of this pretty quickly.
Okay, I think I'm with you in that explanation. It was really detailed, but thank you for that. Do you think we will get to a position where we can draw down, receive, or whatever the terminology is, UK whole government accounts in order to get to that phase two that we had originally planned to get to? Is that going to happen soon, or is it unpredictable?
So there's a really interesting question, I think, that we'd be very happy to discuss further with the committee, in that is, would that be the desired way forward? Because, again, is it about producing another set of accounts? Is it about having a very detailed document with hundreds of pages? Or is it about providing key financial information that will inform and meet the public interest? So because of the absence of the whole of government accounts information, I suppose my proposal is we push ahead with this plan, we provide the information to Audit Scotland and to the committee, and then we can take stock and determine whether, when the whole of government accounts information does become more timely and available, whether that is a direction that we'd want to revert back to.
Okay, and when would we see that as a committee? Maybe next year?
What we'd like to do, so we've got stage one. Stage one we shared with Audit Scotland last year, and we're about to share it. We need to wait for the final outturn to do stage one. Stage two, we're going to start now, and the intention would be that we would share stage two, based on 22-23, with Audit Scotland first, and we'd work through, hopefully in quite an agile way. You know, this is the information, this is how we think it could be presented. I suppose at that point we could then decide whether that pilot was something that the committee would be interested in seeing. But we would hope to reach an agreement on that so that when we do 23-24, then we run the full process through. What we want to do with stage one is next year, we want to link it and align it with the financial outturn reporting. So, because what the financial outturn reporting is doing is reporting spending against the Treasury budgets. So we want to put alongside that the asset and liability information, not just the spend against the budget. We think that's a really nice package and really good timing. So that's our intent as we move forward.
Okay. That sounds very encouraging. I think I'll leave it at that there, Convener. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. I mean, just for the avoidance of doubt, this is a request that's long-standing from the committee dating back to 2016, and I think the committee at that time was promised it in fairly short order, and here we are almost 8 years later, and there's no sign of it. And I think just to be clear, we're not asking for this as a matter of curiosity or some kind of hobbyist interest. We think it's really important, and the Auditor General thinks it's really important that we understand what it is we own and what it is we owe. And, you know, individual components of the public sector are, of course, expected to provide audited accounts so we can see what they own and what they owe. All that we are requesting is that we get something similar across the whole of the public sector in Scotland. And, you know, we recognise that there have been obstacles to that, and there is a latest series of obstacles out with your control. I think you describe it in the letter you sent to us, Permanent Secretary. But I just wanted to reaffirm the stall that we set by this and the importance which we attach to it being tackled urgently. And I think the language of the Auditor General continues to be about this being a deficiency that needs to be addressed with some urgency. I'm going to invite Colin Beattie to come in at this point. Colin.
Thank you, Mayor. I've got a couple of areas I'd like to explore, Permanent Secretary. One of them has been somewhat treaded already, and it's about public service reform, workforce and service redesign. Would you agree with the statement in the report from the Auditor General that the delivery of public services in their current form is not affordable?
Well, we are changing the form, so I suppose the Auditor General's conclusion that without reform there's a significant affordability challenge, you know, or it's not affordable, you know, is fair. And, you know, we've just talked about, for example, if I took the core civil service, we started at a point where there was going to be growth of over 2,000 of just that core SG. Actually, it's been flat. We expect it to be marginally lower, and we've taken contractors out, and we'll continue to do so wherever we can. So we're changing the form and the size of what it would have otherwise been. And I agree with the Auditor General, if we hadn't done that, all other things are such that that would have been unaffordable given what the budget sets us on our total operating cost. Ministers, of course, with the Scottish Fiscal Commission, had a budget envelope that was agreed based on assumptions around growth, tax, the block grant, and then made choices accordingly. So I referenced
some public services, like police, like fire, where there's been significant investment, and that is to protect those services, protect our low crime, to ensure that we can continue to deliver the right preventative community support. But those services are also reforming. And I think the Deputy First Minister set out very clearly to FPAC this week and to Parliament our intent to continue to reform our public services. So we want to go online and be as digital as we can wherever possible. We've got a portfolio of change with regards to that, with regards cloud hosting, around payments, around automations into services wherever it's feasible to do so. Disclosure Scotland, Records Scotland, Social Security are examples where that's working well. We've done some good work on consolidation of public sector estate in Glasgow. The team have more plans to take that out to Perth and Aberdeen and ultimately build a multi-year programme there. Our commercial team, there was a nice article the other day showing how Once for Scotland's commercial procurement around energy contracts across local government has enabled those councils to effect savings compared to what they would have otherwise paid on the open market. So these types of changes are necessary for our public services to deliver better outcomes and be affordable. So I think if we didn't do any of those things, we just carried on without reform, without improvement, without transformation, then there's a significant risk that ultimately it wouldn't be affordable. But I suppose, in the final analysis, the budget has to add up, its requirement based on law. The budget is fixed in terms of, it has its limited levels of flexibility, and therefore, we must ensure that it's affordable and the budget balances. The question is, can we do it and improve outcomes and experiences at the same time, because we transform and improve the way we deliver our public services, and that's what the reform programme is all about.
I'm going to take that in its totality as being a yes, you agree. And given the fact that clearly there isn't affordability, obviously there is an urgency in which to act, because the unaffordability is not going to go away. You're providing some mitigating factors. However, the emergency budget review, the options in that were really non-recurring and provided short-term relief rather than long-term solution, long-term savings, which is what you need. So you are also time-bound within a period in which you have to make it affordable. Otherwise, your budget, as you state, is going to go over its limit, and we can't do that legally. So you must have a time frame in mind in which to achieve that equilibrium between the budget that's going to be available and the changes that you need to make that budget balanced. Otherwise, you're in trouble.
Agreed. And the budget that is before Parliament now for scrutiny for 24-25 seeks to do exactly as you just said in the short term. Alison might just say a bit more then around the medium term and the fiscal strategy and the opportunity to set more multi-year envelopes to enable that longer term planning. The point I'm trying to make is to live within those cash budgets set according to the envelope the Scottish Fiscal Commission have given us, given our tax choices, given our block grant, given our expectations on any additional income. How we lead through that is the opportunity to transform and deliver better outcomes, even when we are facing difficult financial pressures. So a small example on the preventative side, the work on the promise, long way to go, but we're determined to keep the promise and to support whole family wellbeing. We have seen, take Glasgow as an example, a significant reduction of children who are in the care system there. That is improving outcomes for children. It's keeping children safe with their families and supporting their wellbeing. but it's also, of course, reducing cost. And, you know, we want to make sure on prevention, wherever possible, so on Fair Work, supporting more people into work so they can earn more, higher earnings in Scotland, higher revenue. You know, our wellbeing economy strategy is generating increased revenue compared to if those earnings levels were lower. Driving growth, attracting investment, that's what Scottish Enterprise are talking about on Monday. You know, these are all factors in the long-term strategy alongside public service reform. But Alison, can you just say a bit on the medium-term sustainability and the next steps there? That'd be good.
Thanks, Permanent Secretary. Just to pick up on the point around the imperative for reform, the Barnett funding that's available to the Scottish Government has fallen by 1.2% in real terms since the 22-23 budget. So the external conditions are there, that there is a clear driver that we need to be doing things differently to maintain and continue to improve services and outcomes. For 22-23, we did have that emergency budget review, and just to note very briefly there that in that position where we had that inflationary shock, that we did not have funding increasing at the same rate as those inflationary pressures, the Scottish Government had a very limited set of options available, so you end up having to take the savings that are technically available at that point in the year rather than necessarily the ones that you would have designed at the start of the year, and that leads to in general, them being more likely to be non-recurring savings. What we've sought to do through the 24-25 budget work with portfolios is start looking at where we can be recognising those recurrent savings, and where there are opportunities to be reprioritising funding within portfolios towards those areas that have the greatest impact on the government's missions. We're building towards, well, budgets proceeding through Parliament, we're already looking ahead at the same time to the production of the next medium-term financial strategy, which is expected to be presented to Parliament in May. And what that will bring through is our medium-term outlook for the public finances on funding, including tax revenues, and on public spending. And what we'll see there is we'll be starting to draw out what are we expecting the trends to be, what are the drivers of public spending, and what are the actions that we're going to be taking to continue to develop and progress this public spending pillar that was in last year's medium-term financial strategy to improve that underlying sustainability of our public spending. And that, of course, includes the public service reform programme, and we'll be starting to draw out, I think, as we see the programme mature into the delivery phase, what impact that has on our projections of spend in future years.
It seems that much of the changes you're making are in response to in-year budget needs, as opposed to long-term. I'm not really seeing the long-term radical structural changes to create sustainability over a long period. We're seeing responses to whatever money were allocated in a year and the cuts to that and how we respond to that. How do we deal with both? Because sometimes they don't act well together.
Yeah, so I think that is a fair challenge, and that's the intent of this 10-year public service reform programme, to try and ensure that we keep both the long and the short term in view. So I talked at the beginning around the performance report that we've added to the annual accounts based on the feedback from this committee to improve that line of sight. I think we've got more to do there to show short term value for money outcomes and improvement wherever we can towards the medium and long term NPF national outcomes as well. So if I take the point I was making earlier, the budget, we think, has done the right things to protect our mission on equality, to drive child poverty down in Scotland. It is 9 percentage points lower than what it would have otherwise been. And our investment in devolution of social security is ensuring incomes for families with children is higher than what it otherwise would be. We need to continue with the child poverty delivery plan. There's a lot of elements to that, including the work on employment. Again, we've seen good labour market statistics this week for Scotland, unemployment lower than the rest of the UK. So in our long-term strategy around skills, around employment, around tackling poverty, around childcare, this is about ensuring that the positive destinations we have from schools, which are already at good high levels, continue to be sustained, and that our reforms of our systems do indeed affect those long-term changes. But, you know, there are a number of long-term reform programmes underway. Social care, for example, in terms of the National Care Service is one. There's a level of reform underway in the justice system too. As I said, I think we're on a good trajectory there in justice, in terms of clearing court backlogs, in terms of low crime. The prison population, we need to keep it under its operating capacity, obviously, and there's a challenge there with good work underway. But I agree with you. The whole point of the programme is got to balance the budget in the short term and respond to the shocks that we face. And the changes that come, and of course more may come in the March budget from the UK government, more may come after the UK election. But we also need to make sure we're doing the underlying public service reform, as you say, whether that be across child poverty, across economy, towards net zero, or in our public service recovery plan, so that those systems are more resilient for the longer term. And we're going to try and bring those things together. As I say, 6 monthly updates to Parliament from the Deputy First Minister. And we'll try and put more definition into that, both short and long term, so Parliament can see it as clearly as possible. Given the point I was trying to make around ultimately this has to be empowered into systems and led by the boards, the chief executives and those systems for it to be truly meaningful. So they are driving the change. With as much enablement and support that we can muster and give them.
Okay, let me move on to something else, which is about managing financial interventions. The Scottish Government's obviously intervened in a number of places over the years, Prestwick Airport, Ferguson, Byfarb, I suppose, and pretty much all of them have had a fairly significant financial consequence for the Scottish Government. What is the process that's followed by the government when engaging with these private companies, and how the economic analysis behind it supports the decisions that are made?
I'll bring Gregor in if that's okay. The Section 22 report, grateful Audit Scotland have worked really well with us, and the committee sponsored, challenged that work on the private investment framework. I remember the first time I came here, the sort of challenge of when will you finish it, will you get it published? We did finish it, we did get it published. It is establishing a discipline. We established a new capability in terms of strategic commercial assets division. We've recruited Gregor as our DG Economy, who has spent the last few years of his career working for Global Council in the private sector. And we are trying to ensure we're bringing the very best disciplines we can to the management of that portfolio to ensure that independent expert analysis is informing those value for money assessments, to ensure we get the best return for the taxpayer we can and support those assets on their long-term growth and strategies wherever we can as well. But Gregor, do you want to say a bit more about that interaction and anything else you'd like to add?
For sure. So as Permanent Secretary has already suggested, the Strategic Commercial Assets Division, which was set up in July 2022, that's right at the centre of the model that we have introduced. SCAD provides essentially a management model for those interventions over the entire life cycle of the interventions. It provides assurance processes for me, for the Permanent Secretary, for ministers, and does so in a way which is consistent with Audit Scotland recommendations, so working very closely with Audit Scotland. Over the course of that 18-month period, we have introduced a new operating model, so we get that relationship right between the governments, the sponsor teams, and the management teams of those individual assets. The elements of that operating model, that I should emphasise, this is a process of continuous improvement, so we're always trying to work to improve this so that we absolutely get that relationship right with those commercial assets, building on Audit Scotland's advice. It includes ensuring right from the start that we have a very clear rationale for any investment, also that we're able to articulate what the exit strategy is. It's about ensuring with the right capacity, the right capability within government, but also by drawing on external expertise where that's appropriate, so that we can manage that intervention over the course of that life cycle. That means that we need to have the ability to scale up so that we're able to actually have a surge capacity to work much more closely and intensively on particular elements of the intervention. It absolutely means that we deploy best practice, that we learn from what works in one example, and that we take lessons from that and we improve our approach to working with other assets. One of the most important developments I would say over the past 18 months is our ability both internally but then also drawing externally on the right expertise so that we are able to ensure that we are fulfilling our sponsorship functions in exactly the right way, advising our ministers in exactly the right way, and really providing that sort of technical capability so that we can ensure that there's proper budget management, proper risk management, and all of those elements are in place. So it requires us to work closely with each of those assets, but also to respect the fact that those assets have to operate on a commercial basis, and there are some areas where government, quite simply, it's inappropriate for us to get involved. We need to leave the board and the management team the space to make decisions on a purely commercial basis.
So how well would you say that's worked with Ferguson?
I think Ferguson's, we have improved over the course of time. As I said, SCAD was created 21 months ago, a little under 21 months ago. And that has brought better risk management, better scrutiny of costs. We have seen cost increases in the case of Ferguson's, obviously. Those are well known and indeed. We continue to scrutinise costs and the whole question of delivery of the vessels in the case of Ferguson's. We're doing that in a way which ensures that we bring in exactly the right sort of commercial and technical expertise so that we can ensure that everything has been done to bear down in costs and also to manage risk in the best possible way.
Obviously, a big concern is how the decision-making happens in terms of taking a decision to intervene. And I think there's been questions asked about that in the past as to what that process is. Do you consider that process now to be robust?
Yeah, I do. I don't want to be optimistic and trip up tomorrow, so let's try and make sure we don't do that. But I do think those lessons have been well learned, and Gregor genuinely brings huge expertise to this team. And the Auditor General in the Section 22 report recognised that the due diligence that we did on the value for money assessment of 801-802 was robust. And that was done in a very comprehensive way, consistent with the investment framework that was published. And we sought the ministerial authority to proceed, given our value for money assessment. That's the right process. It's as per the public finance manual. It's what this committee, I assume, would expect to see us do. And the auditors have helped ensure that the rigour of that process was comprehensive. I'm very confident that any intervention in the future would step through the same process because of this division that we've created because the learning has been digested properly. And let's be clear, when all is said and done here, what we're in the business of trying to do is deliver better outcomes and in this context, improve the connectivity and lifeline services for our island communities. Calmac the other day confirming the first of our Turkey vessels will come into service this year. We have four of those due in this parliament, plus 801, 802. You know, it is possible we can complete this parliament with six additional vessels into our fleet. And we have the small vessel replacement programme ahead of us as well. So our objectives here are to get the average age of the fleet down, improve resilience, and ultimately recover back to that trend where we were seeing more people using our ferry network than ever before. And that's the service we want to ensure is in place. So these decisions really matter. The learning needs to be embedded into the way we work. And I think we've made big progress with that. But again, I'm very happy to commit to the committee to providing regular updates on the work of that division and the consistency of how that framework's applied. Because like you, I want to make sure the lessons of the past are learned and we optimise value for money moving forward.
Be helpful if that took place. Just moving to Prestwick Airport, I mean, as early as, or late as this morning, we were hearing that there's multiple purchasers interested. And what's the process for assessing these potential buyers? There's been comments made in the past that there's a danger of asset stripping because of the land and so on attached to Prestwick Airport and the possibility it could be sold off for development purposes. How are you assessing these buyers as to what their approach is, how genuine they are, and what the benefit's going to be to the country?
There's a robust process for that, but Gregor will say a bit more.
Yes, so Scottish ministers have said that we do intend for Prestwick to return to private ownership at the appropriate time. We've also said that any decision of that sort would need to be informed by what is right for the success of the business, also its contribution to the local economy. It's also essential when we receive expressions of interest that we pursue those rigorously, but also assess the credibility of those expressions of interest. It is important that if we are to return Prestwick to the private sector, that the proposition will be one which ensures the continued success of Prestwick Airport as an airport, as an aviation business. And it has made considerable progress over the course of the past few years. So in that process, the board clearly plays a role. Government officials play a clear role in bringing advice to administrators. We also draw on external advice, commercial advice in that process. And if necessary, where appropriate, we will conduct due diligence over any parties who have expressed interest to determine their credibility. If it is the case that we get an actual proposal to buy to buy Prestwick Airport that meets those criteria that I've described, and of course Parliament would be the Cabinet Secretary Neil Gray has already committed that he would inform Parliament and update them at the earliest possible opportunity.
How feasible is it to build into this process some certainty that there won't be simply an asset stripper come in?
So the ministerial commitment on that, I think, is very clear. We're looking to ensure...
It's contractual commitments that are needed.
Well, the contractual commitments would be reflected in the ministerial decision and a proposition to return Prestwick Airport to the private sector.
So the intention would be to ensure that there are conditions within the contract that prevented them simply selling off the bits of the assets and being left with a rump airport?
So the intention would be to ensure the continued success of Prestwick as an aviation
business. That's not the same.
Business. The means by which that would be done, that would be determined in accordance with the circumstances at the time and the advice that we would receive from legal advisers and commercial advisers about the best means to do that, to achieve that outcome.
But surely it's not in the interest of the country for someone to take it over and just strip its value out.
We would agree with that. That is not an outcome that we would want to see. Our ministers are very clear.
How are you going to prevent it?
We would take commercial and legal advice to ensure the best possible protection against that outcome, and that would depend. The approach would depend on the circumstances that we find ourselves in at the time and the nature of the proposition, the counterparty that we're dealing with, and it would be tailored to those circumstances to ensure that outcome.
Okay. Just a couple of quick questions then. The framework agreement for Ferguson Marine Port Glasgow was due to be finished by December 23. Has it in fact been finalised?
The agreement is close to being finalised. We expect that to happen within the next month or two, either this month or next month.
Perhaps you'd be able to advise this committee when that's happened?
Yes, of course. Yeah, of course.
And the last thing really is, it's about the due diligence exercise for the MV Glen Sannox and the MV Glen Rosa. This supposedly was done in accordance with the requirements of the SPFM. What information can you share on previous due diligence reviews for these vessels, and what will be available in terms of the review that's currently ongoing?
We received the chief executive of Ferguson Marine informed the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee of cost increases in September 2022, which were then subjected to due diligence. That was provided by Tenio, supported by other technical consultants, including Woodbank Marine. That then, of course, led to the decision to seek written authority, and that written authority being provided by our ministers. That was a complex exercise, but actually a really important exercise, given the importance of those decisions that were taken then. It also required us to interrogate some really commercially sensitive information, and it's because of those commercial sensitivities that we're limited in our ability to publish that information. It has been shared with Audit Scotland. The Auditor General has confirmed that Audit Scotland was provided with full access both to officials and also to documentation, including the due diligence work that supported that decision.
So how much can you provide
authority.
This committee with?
We have provided the committee with as much information as we can, given the commercial sensitivities. Those commercial sensitivities, they get right to the heart of the competitiveness of Ferguson's as a business and what that means in turn for the future commercial success of Ferguson's, which I'm sure we all have a shared interest in ensuring that we do everything possible to ensure that. As I said, Audit Scotland has reviewed the procedure that we followed and the advice that was provided by those third parties, and they've confirmed that was the appropriate approach that we followed leading up to that process of seeking written authority.
Thank you, Mayor.
Okay, thanks. I think Graham Simpson wants to come in on a couple of these points, and then I've got a couple of questions too. So, Graham.
Yeah, thanks very much. So I'm going to ask you about Ferguson and Prestwick. So if we stick with Ferguson for the time being, what was it about proceeding with the Glen Sannox and the Glen Rosa that did not represent value for money?
So we did the due diligence on those revised cost estimates. The requirement for me as an accountable officer under the Public Finance and Accountability Act is to assess the regularity, propriety and value for money for any policy or programme, but specifically in this case, obviously, we were looking at that programme in the light of those revised cost increases. The conclusion that I reached then and the basis of that advice, both from my colleagues within the Scottish Government and also from external advisers, was that the conditions for regularity and propriety were satisfied in both cases. Value for money was satisfied in the case of 801 Glen Sannox. Yeah. But in the case of 802, what we were doing at that moment in time was comparing the estimated cost to complete of 802 Glen Rosa with possible alternatives. And when we did that analysis, given various factors which were creating uncertainty, including the inflationary environment and the progress of the build, we concluded at that time that I couldn't gain sufficient assurance on that question of value for money in the case of Glen Rosa 802.
Yeah, okay. So essentially, you arrived at the conclusion that it would be better value for money, cheaper, shall we say, to procure a vessel elsewhere rather than proceed with the Glen Rosa?
Based on, you're right, a narrow value for money calculation, a comparison between alternatives. Of course, our ministers, when providing that written authority, they take into account wider considerations and benefits, including the timeliness of delivery of the vessels compared to the alternatives, given the lead-in time for that procurement process. And also the wider economic benefits from maintaining shipbuilding and the Clyde, which under the SPFM and the Treasury's Green Book were only able to take into account some of the narrower benefits associated from that.
I understand that, of course. You know, ministers have to consider other things rather than just the cost of the vessel. But in terms of cost of vessel, I think this question has been answered previously, but perhaps you can remind me of what was your estimate of the cost of procuring a new vessel?
That information has not been published, in part because that is itself draws on commercially sensitive information, because if we were to go through another procurement exercise, if we were to release that information, we would be... that would put us at a commercial disadvantage in that process.
Okay, I'll need to check the record, but when I was not a member of this committee and I joined it for a session, I'm pretty sure that Neil Gray did provide an answer to that, but we'll check back on that.
We can check that.
Yeah, we absolutely can check. I mean, you know, one of the benchmarks people sometimes just use is, well, what was the cost of procurement for the vessels that are coming from Turkey? But they are slightly different in terms of scope, and obviously the history... and the service routes and all the rest of it. But let's just double check if it's something we can provide. Not a problem.
Yeah, your analysis is right. I honestly can't see why that should be any big secret. I mean, we know what the vessels in Turkey, of course.
If we were to go through a procurement exercise, we'd be looking to minimise the cost of that procurement.
Of course.
And if we were to disclose a figure which basically said this is the assumption that we make about the cost of that procurement, that would put us at a disadvantage in that process, and that could be costly for...
Yeah, but we're trying to understand why you arrived at a conclusion that it was not value for money to continue with the Glen Rosa as opposed to another option. So figures are quite important in that. Yeah, I completely accept that if you were to go out and procure, we might arrive at a different figure. But you've based your assessment on something.
We based our assessment on the best possible estimate of what the alternative cost would be if we were not to continue with the build of Glenrosa. If we were then to publish that number, that would then potentially put us at a disadvantage if we were to go through such a procurement exercise, because we would have essentially have published a number which would indicate the expectation of what we would expect to pay as part of that process.
So what was your estimate of the cost to complete the Glenrosa?
That was part of that due diligence exercise, and we have shared that information with Audit Scotland. We've always said that it's for the Chief Executive of Ferguson's to update Parliament, to update the NZEC Committee, and of course to come before this committee if his estimates of the cost to complete the vessel change. The due diligence process that we went through, drawing on our commercial advice, not only interrogated those numbers, but also looked at questions of contingency, and was doing that on the basis of an examination of the yard's competitiveness and its ability to deliver those vessels at cost according to the timeline that was being set out at that time. So it was an interrogation in a sense of the competitiveness of the yard at that moment in time.
I asked you for a figure. Are you prepared to give the figure?
We haven't published that figure because it's commercially sensitive.
I know you haven't published it. I'm asking you for it.
The time the analysis was done, and I don't think anything has changed since then.
But that's not commercially sensitive, Mr. Irwin.
The figure is based on an interrogation of the competitiveness of the yard and its ability, the credibility of its estimates of the cost to complete that vessel. And so there is a degree of commercially sensitive information that is inherent within that calculation. And it's for that reason that we did not wish to publish and share that information. We're absolutely committed to being as transparent as we can be with this committee and in public, and indeed publishing material where possible. We also have a requirement that we should not put the yards at a competitive disadvantage, so that we can do everything that we possibly can to secure a sustainable future for the yard.
That wouldn't put the yard at a competitive disadvantage. We only want to know what the estimate of the cost of completing that vessel was. That's not affecting its competitiveness. It shouldn't be a secret.
It's set out in quarterly updates, isn't it, from the Chief Executive?
So what's the answer?
The Chief Executive is, as the Permanent Secretary has indicated, he comes before the Net Zero and Energy and Transport Committee once a quarter, and he provides any updates to the estimated cost.
I'm aware of that, but you're here in front of the Public Audit Committee and you're being asked for a figure, and you're trying to hide behind the Chief Exec.
I'm trying to explain that when we commission external due diligence, which interrogates the competitiveness position of the yard and its ability to build vessels and the cost associated with building those vessels, the detail of that is commercially sensitive, and that potentially jeopardises our efforts to ensure that the yard enjoys a strong, commercially successful, sustainable future.
Okay. Have you decided, or has a decision been made yet, on how much the Scottish Government is prepared to invest in the yard, in terms of upgrading equipment there? Because we know that the Chief Exec has asked for further investment. He was turned down, and there was there is going to be a review. Has that taken place?
So the yard did submit a business plan and an investment plan. With any investment proposition of that sort, we're legally required to demonstrate that government support would comply with subsidy control requirements, and that includes that we would be acting in a manner which would be consistent with the way in which a commercial market operator would act. We commissioned external due diligence on that, and we reached the position we were unable to be satisfied that we would meet that commercial market operator test on that proposal. Mm-hmm. What we've been doing with the yard since then is working with them to revise their business plan and the investment plan that is associated with that. We have supported a request from the yards for them to be to have the budget to hire external advisors to make sure that that investment plan and business plan is as rigorous as it possibly can be. That work is still ongoing, and we hope to receive a revised business plan investment plan from the yard soon, and we will examine that carefully, and if we can find a way to do it in a manner which is consistent with subsidy control, then of course that is a proposition that we'll be able to take to ministers.
What happens if you can't find a way to do it?
We absolutely want to do what we can to ensure that we invest in the yards in a way that allows us to secure its commercial future, to provide that pathway to a sustainable commercial future. The exercise that we're going through now is essentially to try and ensure that the plan that emerges from the yards can be consistent with the subsidy control regime. If the proposition that comes back does not do that, then of course we have the option of trying that again. We are bound to comply with the legal regime. We have brought in advisors to support the yards as they develop that plan. You've heard David Tideman here describe his optimism about the potential for the yard to win orders, future business. Yeah. We need to make sure that we are supporting the yards in the best way that we can, but in a manner which is consistent with the legal framework that we have to operate within.
Okay, in the interest of time, I'll just go back onto Prestwick Airport. I'm just trying to understand the process. So what happens when somebody approaches the airport with an expression of interest in buying it? It goes first to the board, and the board should then tell you there's been an expression of interest. And what happens after that?
What happens after that is our officials will work, they will typically work with the boards to examine the credibility of the entity that is expressing that interest, and also to examine the nature of that interest and what the proposition is from that entity. At some point in that, of course, our ministers will be informed of this throughout. At some point during that process, we may conclude that we need to draw an external commercial advice. That may take the form of due diligence concerning the entity that has expressed interest. We need to test whether they are credible purchasers. That's partly a question of the individuals themselves, but also the financial strength of that entity, their ability to raise finance, if that is what is being proposed, but also their skills and expertise within the aviation sector. Mm-hmm. And the nature of the plan that they have for Prestwick Airport as an aviation business. So it's a combination of the board working with officials and drawing on the right sort of external advice at the right moment in the process.
Is it the case that you're taking your main advice from the board, or is it actually your decision? So if the board said, we don't really want to sell, which is my impression of the board, could you potentially take a different view and say to the board, well, no, this actually looks okay to us.
So we are the shareholder. This is a decision for the Scottish Government, for our ministers. Our ministers have said that when the moment is right, we want to return Prestwick to the private sector. The board has within it considerable expertise, and we respect that and we draw on that. But of course, as part of our sponsorship function, we need to be also rigorously test what we hear from the board as well. Yeah. And external advice can certainly help to support that process, because of course that external advice is independent.
Okay, so leave it there, convener. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. And again, we are a little bit up against the clock, but we've got a couple of other areas that we want to ask you about. Just before we move on, can I ask you, Permanent Secretary, what your view is on the fact that the written authority that was sought this year was the first one since 2007?
Well, I think the written authority was well done, and Audit Scotland have given us that confidence level.
But do you think there have been so few concerns about ministerial spending decisions in all that time that it wouldn't have been warranted at any point?
I think you might have asked me this question before, and it's a bit hard for me to judge. Since I have been Permanent Secretary, that has been the first time where we have judged it was necessary. And, of course, myself, the Chief Finance Officer, worked with Gregor on that. So it is obviously an exceptional process, which is not sort of routine. My experience in Whitehall was, you know, they were very few and far between. But when they happened, there was an understandable reason, you know, for example, support grants in an environment where fraud and error checks might not be possible, but it's an emergency economic context. So I suppose what I can say to the committee is I'm committed to ensuring the public duties expected of us as accountable officers, that things are lawful, proper, regular, value for money, are tested on a regular basis. And Jackie and I stepped through the AO control process on all our expenditure, and we're constantly testing that. The vast majority of the time, where there is a concern or a doubt with regards to that, there is a dialogue with ministers to ensure that we are delivering value for money, because of course that's what they want to do as well. But I don't particularly have a commentary on what happened before I was Permanent Secretary here, because I didn't experience it, and I don't know the nature of the conversations, which meant those authorities were not required at the time.
Okay. I'm going to move on to another quick question for you. Strategic Commercial Assets Division.
Yeah.
Do you consider the Petro Ineos oil refinery at Grangemouth a strategic commercial asset?
Well, Grangemouth is clearly a critical part of Scotland's national infrastructure. And Ineos and PetroChina are essential partners in business there. Our ministers have been working with Grangemouth in terms of a just transition plan and what's the right thing for our energy transition for many years. I don't know, Gregor, if there's anything more you want to say on the latest interaction there. You know, we'll continue to do everything we can to make sure that the transition that Grangemouth is going through, people are supported in terms of jobs, but also we're getting the right assurances we need from the UK government with regards to our energy security. But, Gregor, anything else you want to add?
Yeah, so the Petro Ineos clearly said that they're planning to build import infrastructure. They've also said that they have not yet reached a final decision on the future of refining at Grangemouth. Planning to ensure that whether there is refining continues at Grangemouth or that import capability exists, that will ensure that access to fuel will be continuous, and that will be available from the Grangemouth facility for many years to come under different scenarios. So that is important from a strategic perspective. It is also the case that there are a number of different companies and operations that make up the Grangemouth cluster. The refinery is one part of that, an important part of that, but there are other companies that make up the Grangemouth cluster. And we've been doing work for a while, and we continue to do work, and it's important to support that cluster as it transitions. And we see lots of opportunities, and indeed the companies who are involved in that cluster see lots of opportunities from low-carbon hydrogen production, from biorefining, from carbon capture and storage. So that work is ongoing, and clearly it's very important that we do that right.
So can I take from that that you do consider the oil refinery to be a strategic commercial asset? And it, I mean, is it been, does it fall within the scope of your strategic commercial asset division?
It doesn't, in the sense that strategic commercial assets, the term strategic commercial assets refers to assets of the Scottish Government. The strategic commercial assets division is responsible for our interventions, and indeed the process that might lead up to an intervention, but that is most definitely a step of last resort. There are other things that we do to support businesses in a range of different circumstances well before there's any question of financial intervention. But we've already discussed Ferguson's and Prestwick Airport, which are two important assets of the Scottish Government, strategic commercial assets.
OK. Let me move on to another industrial intervention, which is contained in the report, and that's the Lochaber aluminium smelter, which brings us into the relationship between the Scottish Government and the GFG alliance. And the words of the Auditor General are again pretty clear this year. Not only has he chosen to include it in his Section 22 report into the Scottish Government's consolidated accounts, he says there continues to be uncertainty regarding the financial stability of the GFG alliance. And he goes on to point out the potential liability to the public purse has increased by £21 million since last year, now to an exposure of £135 million. I mean, how are you managing that? What's your response to that? And isn't it looking increasingly likely that this whole investment could run into difficulty? I mean, it was reported, I think, at the weekend, that the former chief executive of the Wylands Bank, which again was part of the GFG alliance, was fined £110,000 by the Bank of England's Prudential Regulatory Authority. There are serious fraud office investigations into the GFG alliance. Various House of Commons select committees have cast doubts about the business model of the GFG alliance. The last time we took evidence from you, they had failed to submit audited accounts. Where is your relationship with the GFG alliance, and what is the current position as you understand it, given that risk and uncertainty as identified by the Auditor General?
The business at Lochaber, it is operating well at the moment. The smelter is generating revenue. The business has strong, important links with the local community. There are 214 jobs currently at the complex. That's 40 more than in 2016. Just last year, 7 new graduate apprenticeships were created by Lochaber. So far, the Lochaber guarantee, it's meeting not just its economic objectives, it's meeting its financial objectives. It generates income for the Scottish government, as you will have seen from the accounts. We have increased the provision. That does reflect market developments over the course of the financial year for the accounts. The value of the security has decreased, but we have a strong suite of securities, which includes the smelter, the hydro and the estates. We have a robust approach to monitoring that and to the relationship with GFG. We have a quarterly guarantee meeting with GFG staff and smelter staff. I visited the site, I believe you have as well, Permanent Secretary. We've heard the investment plans that are being progressed for the site. They now have planning permission for the billet facility there. So we do have regular engagement at both official level and ministerial level. We also, that work is supported by external commercial advisors. We interrogate carefully everything that we hear from GFG Alliance. We think it's absolutely important that we are planning for all possible contingencies. And as I've said, that suite of securities is a strong one. The provision in the accounts, it is informed by a technical assessment of a range of credit risk scenarios. Those are provided by independent advisors. It's not a forecast of likely outcomes in respect of the guarantee. And the Auditor General has said that our approach in setting that provision against the potential exposure, that is a reasonable one.
You said that you've met representatives of the GFG Alliance. When was the last time the Scottish Government or one of its representatives met with Sanjeev Gupta?
I'm afraid I couldn't tell you that at the moment, but we could certainly find that out and share that information.
And what's the latest position, Mr. Irwin, on the submission of audited accounts?
We have discussed this with GFG. We have pressed them to, we have emphasised to them the importance of satisfying audit requirements. They have told us that the appointment of auditors in the UK is a priority for them. Clearly, that is something that we think that they should address, and it's important that they should address it. And we hope that progress will be made there in the near future.
OK, I'm going to move us on to the final couple of areas that we wanted to speak to you about. One was around the corporate transformation programme. So again, in the audit report, I think paragraphs 84 and 85 talk about this remind us of the escalation in cost and the slippage in timetable of these new systems for HR and finance. I think the original cost was estimated to be £22 million. It's now almost doubled. It's gone up to £40 million. And the date of implementation, I think, was meant to be the middle of last year for the HR system and the end of last year for the finance system. And I think we're now told it's not going to be until April of this year. Could you provide us with an update on where that is? And are you going to meet those revised timetables?
So I think you're right, Convener. We've got to get this right. And Audit Scotland have quite reasonably called for a number of years out the fact that the underlying systems and processes were not fit for purpose, and there had been a deficit of investment in these core systems. And of course, it's not just core SG, it's over 30 public bodies who are dependent on these systems too. You've seen some examples where this has not gone well. I'm very determined that we do it and make sure the implementation is as safe and secure as possible. You're quite right, the intent was for the end of this financial year. I think it's going to be this calendar year. I don't think it will be April. I think we need to take a few more months in testing just to conclude on the final business processes necessary to implement this really safely. That doesn't change the cost of the system to the government, but it just, I think, is the right thing to do, partly also to do with year-end reconciliation, that we, when we do the cutover, you know, there has to be a freeze on the data and on recruitment, for example, for that short period. So we'll finalise that accordingly. And as you say, Audit Scotland have had access and gone through the revised business case, and that has been affected by, inflation and those costs, but I'm very determined to keep those costs down within that business case as much as I can, but also to recover or to maximise the benefits from the system change for those public bodies and for the government, so we get an improved efficiency longer term. So we're working on all of that.
And is there an external IT contractor involved?
Well, the product is Oracle ERP, so yes, in that regard. We are not configuring our own in that way in terms of it being an in-house agile development or anything like that. It is an off-the-shelf mainstream service, a software service. And so in that regard, it's well tested and has been, you know, delivered many times by many other organisations. But it is the most complex internal IT implementation, certainly, that I've done in Scotland. So we wanted to make sure we get it right. And I'm very happy to keep the committee updated as those plans progress through the year.
Yeah. I mean, with these kind of contracts, is there never any consideration of a fixed price contract being agreed rather than some kind of cost plus evolving, ever increasing price tag?
Yeah. I mean, I don't know, Jackie, if you want to say anything more around the commercial strategy. Jackie's leading in the finance strand for this, but I'm happy to review that because, you know, we obviously want to make sure we get best value for money for the taxpayer. But Jackie, anything to add on that?
I think just really briefly, I would just reinforce some of the points the Permanent Secretary made. This is a really complex programme of work. This is not just about replacing the finance and HR systems for core Scottish Government, but it's over 30 public bodies and agencies as well. So this is whilst we are adopting the Oracle Cloud system, there are still specific integrations and data considerations that we just need to get right. And the way that we work through those is working through the programme. And there has been tremendous progress in terms of working through the programme. But it is inevitable, just due to the overall complexity of the programme, that there are things that need to be addressed and that become a pattern as you move through the programme. So I'm not an expert on IT contracts, but I would suggest that, you know, one of the drawbacks with a fixed price contract is that it would actually constrain you from optimising the implementation of the system and the benefits that come alongside it. And as the Permanent Secretary alluded to, although we've got 30 bodies at the moment, we are adopting a fairly standardised shared service platform that we would hope would help us drive some of the efficiencies that we want to meet more broadly in the public sector going forward.
Okay, just on that last point, because I think it comes back to the conversation we've had today around efficiency and effectiveness. As Jackie said, if we can establish this platform well, we've seen recently on our energy procurement for contracts with local government, when we do it once for Scotland, we can get a better deal, better outcomes for less cost. So we want to keep putting in place platforms, common enablers that all our public sector can utilise to reduce cost, and that will support fiscal sustainability.
Okay. And again, just sorry, my ignorance. I haven't started reading Computer Weekly just yet, although it's been in the news quite a lot recently. So Oracle, is that the name of the software, or is that the name of the company that provides it, or who is the IT provider? What's the name of the commercial outfit that's providing that?
So it's Oracle Cloud, yeah. It's the commercial.
That's
outfit.
The company name.
Yeah, and then the product is an ERP product for us. But again, if a bit more detail on this would be helpful, we could get for the SRO to keep the committee updated and to provide that to you if you wish.
Thanks, Permanent Secretary. I mean, we do get regular reports on IT projects, so
yes.
So we do get an opportunity to view and review those.
Okay.
Could I, as we're on this subject of software, finish up and turn to our resident in-house expert on all these matters, and that's Willie Coffey. Willie, do you want to ask the final couple of questions?
Thanks very much for that, convener. Oracle is well-established, trustworthy, and I'm just glad that it's not called Horizon and it's not riddled with bugs that will end up putting people in jail. I think that's important to put that on the record. Very respected software, so I look forward to seeing the developments with that. I can't let the opportunity pass, convener, Permanent Secretary, since Prestwick was mentioned earlier as an Ayrshire MSP. I was listening very carefully to what you were saying and what Mr Irwin was saying, and I'm assured by what you said about Prestwick and taking into account all the factors that are important for us, particularly in Ayrshire, about supporting the airport. I think the government was right to step in 2013 to save the airport, saved thousands of jobs, but it kept this, the aerospace industry clearly established in that part of Scotland. It's a major strategic industry for Scotland as a whole. One plea I would have if we ever do proceed to think about selling the airport is to make sure all of that activity is protected and retained, but also to try to encourage further development of the passenger traffic at Prestwick, because a lot of people in my part of the world, convener in Ayrshire, feel compelled to travel to Glasgow or Edinburgh and further afield when they would really prefer to use Prestwick if they happen to be fortunate enough to fly off to places during the summer or whenever else. So that would be a plea from my constituents, and I'm sure my Ayrshire colleagues that would be part of any deal.
It's nice to finish with that comment, Mr. Coffey, because last time we spoke about this, we talked about the wider value for money economic benefits that Prestwick has brought. We have got that economic assessment underway as part of that due diligence, and again, very happy to keep the committee updated on that. Certainly my experience from visiting the airport, I was very impressed by the chair. There was a very compelling strategy for growth and to diversify the airport. And as Gregor has set out, our ministers are clear that, you know, any purchase of the airport must be done in a way that protects that asset. And of course, the voice of the local community would be an essential part of that engagement too. So I think ministers share your determination, and we share the view that, although I know the portfolio of assets we've discussed today have a level of novelty about them, it is quite possible that Prestwick will continue to make a profit, deliver a good return, and be a success story. And we'll be doing everything we can to support them in that endeavour. And we'll do that economic assessment and, of course, make it available publicly. So that the wider benefits for the supply chain, for jobs, for business, for growth, are as clear as they can be.
Thank you so much for that. I wasn't quite finished.
Oh, it's okay. Sorry.
The final area I was hoping to cover was on general performance reporting. And the Auditor General made some significant comments. I think you, in your opening remarks, again mentioned performance reporting has to be mission-led government that transforms services. Now, the Auditor General made some key comments, I think, saying that the government's approach to public performance reporting needs to improve. And he mentioned a whole load of indicators there. Could you just give us a little flavour, finally, of how this is improving and what will the value of the performance reporting framework look like for the public? How would the public be able to see improvements in performance right across the public sector?
So I think this is really important for us as a government, as a parliament, for devolution. I went on a visit recently to Young Scot, and we were talking about how the country is changing. But so much of kind of what we understand in terms of underlying trends was not understood, and it wasn't sufficiently visible and explained, which is obviously disappointing. We want to improve that. So this committee gave the good challenge of getting the performance report into the accounts. We've made that start. I think we all accept that it's still a little bit too annual account-ish in terms of its density. We've tried to almost include everything and lost the story. So we do want to really make sure we can refine for the strategic narrative what are the key missions that this government is seeking to achieve. So on equality, on opportunity, on community. What does that mean in real terms? It means child poverty being lower in Scotland compared to the rest of the UK, regions, nations. We can evidence that already, 9 percentage points. We are determined to meet our statutory targets and get to that relative poverty target by 2030. When we come into the opportunity mission, indicators around foreign direct investment, around exports, around growth, around earnings, fair work. We have a collection of indicators that we can see progress on relative rest of the UK towards that net zero just transition, emissions falling towards 2045. And then in that opportunity mission for justice, courts backlog down a third. We want to get rid of those backlogs in this parliament. education, positive destinations at record highs. How do we make sure on health and social care? We've seen some good improvement and reduction in drug deaths. We want to continue that trend through the years ahead. Plan care backlogs, longest waits. So for the key indicators against the key missions, showing the data as a trend data, where were we, where are we, where are we trying to get to achieve our national outcomes, and have we made progress in the short and medium term? That's what mission-led government means. Our governance is constructed to drive that through. So people sometimes talk about the implementation gap. We are trying to close that gap and to be clear that the strategy, the change programmes, the capabilities, the investment, the delivery are aligned. And you as a committee in Parliament can hold us to account on that. So that those outcomes, the end of this Parliament, the end of the decade, are improving. And of course, where that's not the case, and we have a challenge, we've had that recently with regards to the prison population, we're able to set out to Parliament what we're doing about it to mitigate a risk, contained to live within our operating capacity. So we'll keep working on the performance report to make sure it tells that strategic narrative aligned with the missions. We're publishing the mandate letters accordingly. I think there's opportunities for more real-time data linked to the NPF, so it's not historic with the gaps that it currently has, so that we can show in more real terms, are we making progress against the key indicators? So that's the journey we're on. I think it's getting better, but I agree, we've still got more to do, and Audit Scotland are helping with that challenge, and we'll keep responding to that as best we can.
Okay. On that positive note, thank you very much. Thank you, convener.
Okay, Willie, thank you very much. And I will now draw this morning's proceedings to a close, but can I do so and thank the Permanent Secretary, John-Paul Marx, for your time and your willingness to answer the questions that we've had this morning. It's greatly appreciated. And also, can I thank Greg Irwin, Jackie McAllister and Alison Cumming for also giving us the benefit of their insights into the way that government is working and the reform programme and how that is progressing. I am going to move the committee into private session, so I will close the public part of this morning's meeting. Thank you very much. Thank you.